Good morning. I want to welcome all of our visitors here today and our normal members, and we're glad that you came, and we pray that you're going to be blessed with this service. You'll notice that we had planned on Eric Fridge coming to speak, but Allen had a change in his plans for his surgery, and so he's going to be speaking for us today, and Eric will be preaching next Sunday, for I understand. Allen's going to have surgery Tuesday, and we want to keep him in our prayers and bless him with that surgery and hope it comes out very well and that everything works out good for him on that. If you're visiting with us, we really want to tell you how happy we are for you to be here. We also really want to make your visit as pleasant as possible. And so if there's any of you looking for a classroom or something to do with your kids, just be sure and ask any one of us when we point you in the right direction. And if you need a small group to come to tonight, anyone here will be glad to point you in the right direction to that and to help you any way we can. As most of you know, we've been having the budget discernment process going on from January 1st, and our last week of that will be next week. So if you could, make sure that you've got your contribution up to date, because we're going to use that as our benchmark for the rest of the year in setting our budget. This has worked out very well for us over the last 3 to 4 years, and we think it's God's plan for us, and that we're being good stewards by doing it this way. Right now we're right at $9,000 a month. That's about what our budget was last year, and so if you plan on increasing your giving, please take care of that between now and the end of this month, which is next service. The other thing that needs to be taking place is your surveys. We've passed those out last week, and I have had a couple of people ask me what to do with them today, and we took them up, and we have the box in the back that we use for so many of these things like that that's available. Or any one of the elders that you see, you can hand it to them. But we really would like to get those surveys in by next week if we could. We'll probably have to give a little bit of a grace period on that and continue that on into maybe the first week of April. But we would really like each one of you to fill it out, to be honest with what your answers and your thoughts, and help us to make good decisions over the next 10 or so years. One other thing I wanted to clarify was the Harrison small group, my small group, has two couples, Dean and Gail Murphy and Billy and Cindy, that will be moving to Saudi Arabia over the next few months. And so we decided we wanted to do something for them in our small group, and then we thought, well, heck, we don't need to just limit it to our group, so we wanted to invite all of y'all to attend small group with us next Sunday here at the service, at the church, at 6 o'clock, if you'd like to come and participate. And we'll have our normal devotional and some song and singing, and that's covered. But anyone that would like to come is invited. Don't feel obligated to come. If your small group is doing something else, that's perfectly fine. But we wanted to invite you and invite you to bring finger foods. The rest of our announcements are in the caring and sharing. We invite you to open that up and look at it and see all the other things that we've got going on and coming up. I'd like to read Romans 8, verses 12 through 17 with you, if I could. It says, therefore, brothers, we have an obligation, but it's not to the sinful nature to live according to it. For if we live according to the sinful nature, you will die. But if by the Spirit you will put to death the misdeeds of your body, you will live. Because those who are led by the Spirit are God's sons, are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the spirit of sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we were God's children. Now that we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in this suffering, in order that we may also share in his glory. You know, I grew up in a family where the I love you was spoke a lot to us, and our parents were free with that, and we heard it all the time. It wasn't really a big deal. But I didn't really realize how much they loved me till I had children. And once I got those, then I realized that. And we need to think about that with our God and Father, how much he loves us. At least as a perfect father, he loves us as much as we love our children. So as we gather together and sing and pray, we want to worship our God and Father and give him the glory. Thank you.
Let us stand for this next song.
Worthy is all, Lamb was slain, holy, holy is he. Sing in his song, to him to sit on, heaven's mercy see.
Would you bow with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we're grateful to be here this morning. We're grateful to have the strength and the ability to gather in your house, to have you in our presence, and to know that you love us. Father, we ask as we go through each day of our lives that we find ways to serve you, that we love one another, that we share with each other what we have, even to the extent of giving up what we may want. But Father, we know that you will provide us what we need. Heavenly Father, we ask that you watch over those who lead our nation and the nations around the world. Help them to find ways to create peace and harmony within nations. Help us to know the right things to do, the right words to say, the right actions to take to serve you. Father, we ask an extra measure of blessing on those who serve in our military. We know that that's a difficult task, and they serve so that we may have the freedom to stand here and to sing praises to you and lift our words of prayer to you and know that we can do it in freedom. Father, you know the list of folks on our prayer list today. We ask for an extra measure of blessing on them, particularly on our congregational leader, Allen, and his family, as you know we love them and we know you love them. Help them to through this procedure. May all go well. And may we continue to serve you in the best way possible. Father, we know that our Savior Jesus is all that we need. He is our everything. You sent him to walk among us, to provide an example for us, and ultimately to die and then be born again so that we may know that there is that possibility. Heavenly Father, when we gave up our sins and accepted you in our lives, we knew that this was not going to be a short journey or an easy journey. We know that each and every day of our lives, there are struggles that are and impediments that are placed before us. But we know that if we turn to you, if we follow your word, if we do your will. Father, all things will be done in your fashion. Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with us today as we lift up our voices in song to you. We know that you hear our prayers, and we're grateful for that. Father, help us to serve you well, not just when we gather here on Sundays, but each and every day of our lives. Help us to know that the journey of being a Christian never ends. It's an ongoing process. We move ahead each day, we learn more each day, and if we ever become satisfied with where we are or what we've done, then we have failed. Father, help us to strive every day to serve you better and to know that you love us and that we are grateful. Father, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
We gather here in Jesus' name. His love is burning in our hearts like living flame.
When I travel with my father, and my family travels with my father, he doesn't like to stop and eat at a fast food restaurant. He likes to find a local place, and he likes to sit down. And it was always a great time for me when we traveled, that we could sit down there and fellowship and talk and share great stories and just share memories. And he liked to turn around and include and talk to people around us, too. I mean, he was just a really good and friendly guy. But you know, Paul and Barnabas and Timothy and the apostles and many of the early Christians, they've traveled a lot too. And they traveled spreading the word of Jesus, that Jesus was the Christ, the Savior, the Son of God, that he came and had died on a cross to save all of us from sin. And as they traveled and taught this and spread that word, they ate many meals with many new believers, many new Christians throughout. But they shared a special meal, a special supper, the Lord's Supper. They taught and told these new Christians how they had sat with and ate the last Passover with Jesus, and shared with them that this bread and that this cup represented Jesus and his sacrifice. And we share in that today as we partake in this Lord's Supper. And we share in that as we think back on the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. And we remember that his sacrifice and his life was to save us. So let's do that as we partake in the bread and the cup. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we give thanks for your Son Jesus, and we remember his life, his teachings, that he came to this earth and lived, and that he died on a cross to be a sacrifice for all our sins, that we might be saved, and that we might be resurrected as he and as a new person. And dear Lord, as this new person, we pray that you be with us every day and help us to lead a life that glorifies you and reflects your glory. And in this we pray, in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we take of this cup, we again remember your Son Jesus and reflect back on his life, but we remember that his blood was shed for us, that blood cleanses us, and we are thankful for that. And again, we just pray that you help us to live a life that glorifies you, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. God has blessed us in so many ways, and blessed us to live in a great city and a great state and a great country, where we're blessed with many advantages and that people in other countries are not. And we, at this time, we remember those blessings and we take this time to give back to the Lord. And, you know, not only did he bless us with, you know, his son that saves us, but he blesses us in our lives. And although he never promised us to that these lives that we live are going to be easy or perfect or without troubles, he does promise that he walks with us. He'll be with us on this as we live this life. And you know, let's remember that as we take this time to give back to the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, again, we give thanks for all your many blessings, from Jesus, your Son, to just being with us in our daily lives as we live and helping us through this world that is filled with tough times and tough things. And as we remember that, we take this time to give back to you so that we might here as a church and congregation be able to try to spread that blessing to others that you've blessed us with, and that we might be able to bring more and tell more and into this family, and so that they might feel your love and blessings. And dear Lord, in all this we pray, it's in your Son's name. Amen.
I want to live.
Let's all stand as we dismiss for Praise Kids, and we'll sing 10,000 Reasons as they're leaving.
Sing like never.
Seated, please.
Scripture reading this morning is from Acts chapter 16, the first five verses. Paul came to Derbe and then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was Jewish and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. The believers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him. Paul wanted to take him along on the journey, so he circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. As they traveled from town to town, they delivered the decisions reached by the apostles and elders in Jerusalem for the people to obey. So the churches were strengthened in the faith and grew daily in numbers.
We don't want to leave out that strengthening of the apostles, amen? Strengthening of the church. Well, surprise. I'm surprised to be here. I was surprised on Tuesday that they told me that I would be able to be here. And we'll hear a little bit more about that a little bit later in the sermon, because in a very unique sense, I've been living out a little bit of the concept that the text is teaching us today. We're thankful to be gathered together, and we're thankful for each individual that's a part of this gathering, and somebody that has been a part of our gatherings for the last several years, George Belize. George is on the back here. George, would you stand right quick? George is joining the Air Force, and he is going off to basic training and is going to be doing some things and away from us. And as best we know, they're not putting an Air Force base in Lake Jackson soon, at least. And so we're going to be missing George. Amanda will be following following him after basic and after his first school. And George, we're thankful that we have enjoyed your being part of our services and part of our congregation, and we ask God's blessings on you as you head in that new direction. Amen, church. Amen. Thank you. Next Sunday will actually be his next Sunday, but unless a door gets closed, that at this point would be really, really shocking, I won't be here next Sunday. So I wanted to be sure and mention George while I had the opportunity today. Well, it doesn't look like it now, but there was a time when I was a runner. In fact, I was a 15-mile-per-week runner. You should all go, ooh, like that. That's right. But that was, as you can say, a very long time ago. In that time, I learned that there's something very interesting about runners, especially those that kind of get involved in it in a big way, is there's a certain kind of insanity that begins to take place. Runners who really get dedicated will run in absolutely anything. They will run if it's cold. They will run if it's rainy. They will run if it's rainy and cold. I have been out on a run and the rain shifted to sleet and began to snow before we were done. I've been on a run where I had to pick one of my running partners up because he slipped on the ice that was on the road. This is insanity. We are doing something that's supposed to be healthy for us, and we're doing it in conditions in which we are subjecting our health to a lot of adverse circumstances. And the whole church said, amen. Amen. One of the things about running that you learn is that if you're going to go out on a run and you're going to do it on a regular basis, you're going to wind up with a few days where you have to run against the wind. And it can be a punishing thing. We get pretty good wind here. We get a lot of wind in Central Texas. It isn't Amarillo wind. I have to admit that it's not Amarillo wind. But when the wind blows, you're eventually going to wind up running into it. And running into the wind, against the wind, is a punishing sort of thing. It takes your energy away from you. It works to take the will to continue to run against you. It pushes in the direction that you're trying to go. It catches every single part of your clothing and seems to make that a sail and push you the opposite direction. It is discouraging. You don't run in form anymore. You begin to bend over and you're just kind of, your strides generally shorten up a little bit. You're just trying to get against the wind, and it almost seems that the wind doesn't want you to get there. But every run that you take that's against the wind, if, of course, you're running in a loop where you're going to come back home, and I never did run with a sense that I was going somewhere. I always came back home. You get to turn. And you get to run with the wind. And as much as running against the wind is a struggle, running with the wind can lift you in a way that very few other things do. Your endorphins seem to kick in almost instantaneously. Your breath returns to you very quickly. Your stride is no longer a struggle, but it seems that you can stretch even further and get a longer stride out of it. You just go. And although I was never one of these runners, there are people who claim, it's on a day like today, I could just keep running forever. By the time I got to the 5-mile marker, I was done. It didn't matter how good I felt that day, I was going to be done. But it feels when you turn and run with the wind that you can go on forever. There is nothing, absolutely nothing, like running with the wind. The wind is a powerful image. Jesus picks it up in his conversation with Nicodemus. And John writes about that conversation and he says, you see the wind. You see it blowing. You see its evidence. And it is like the Spirit. You don't always know where it comes from. You don't know what causes it. You can't actually hold it in your hands, but when it moves, you know it. We believe in something we can't see, but we know is acting. There's more reasons why Jesus ties it to the idea of wind. The word itself kind of is similar. The word for spirit and the word for breath or wind can all kind of be tied together. When the Spirit comes on the day of Pentecost, at the very beginning of our book, it is with the sound of a blowing wind. Not just kind of any blowing wind, but the loud blowing wind. The Spirit was moving in a way that maybe it hadn't ever moved before, and the wind would be heard as it moved. And while the book of Acts doesn't regularly talk about the wind blowing every single time that the Spirit shows up, the book of Acts, every single step of the way, talks about the wind of the Spirit. The wind of the Spirit initiates on the day of Pentecost. The wind of the Spirit initiates as the disciples pray and as they go about the business of being church. The wind of the Spirit blows when the church meets opposition. The wind of the Spirit blows when they're ready to open, when God is ready to open the gates of the church to Gentiles. The wind of the Spirit blows as the message of the gospel spreads further and further afield. We would have to state as fact, if we read the book of Acts the way that Luke wrote it, we would have to say that the church wouldn't be anywhere and wouldn't do anything if it were not for the wind of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. It is a powerful idea that fills up these pages. And in this central section of the book, it's very interesting how the book kind of folds around this little transition here. We read about the letter to the Gentiles last week, and now the mission continues to go on. And Luke presents us at the end of 15 and the beginning of 16 with three different scenes that talk about, I believe, in a very powerful sort of way, the way the Spirit continues to lead the church. Join me and let's read from the first of those scenes. Sometime later, Paul said to Barnabas, "Let us go back and visit the brothers in all the towns where we preach the word of the Lord, and let's see how they are doing." Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with them, but Paul did not think it wise to take him, because he had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in the work. They had such a sharp disagreement that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark and sailed for Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and left, commended by the brothers to the grace of the Lord. He went through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. We don't like this scene because it is amazing. We don't like the idea of our heroes disagreeing. What are we to do with that? How are we to look at it? But if you read Scripture, if you read the Gospels, if you read the book of Acts, if you read Paul's letters, what you're going to discover is that there is always going to be disagreements of those people who follow Jesus. There's going to be times and places where friendships are divided over disagreements. There's always going to be a sense in which we're committed to things, and because of our commitment to them, it will cause us to head in two different directions. It's not something we like, because each of us have been in the middle of one of these relationships before. Maybe we've been in multiple ones. And it bothers us, because the relationship is so important. And we don't like the way that the relationship comes into disagreement and to conflict. And conflict is one of those things that we think, surely God can't be doing anything with this. Well, Satan would want to use disagreements in that way. Satan would want to take conflict between those who are like-minded in Jesus Christ but not like-minded on a particular topic and use it to create discord, to use it to create chaos, to use it to create discouragement. But as we read this story, we notice something very, very, in my opinion, interesting. They disagree. They disagree about what you're going to do with John. John, who was mentioned a little bit earlier in chapter 14 of the story, is having left them, and you're kind of wondering, what in the world does that have to do with anything, except that Luke always has a reason why he mentions a name. It doesn't always come up back in the book again, but very often that name that's mentioned earlier comes back again, and we need to be sure we understand what that story was so we can understand this story. We are never told why John was discouraged and left Paul and Barnabas the first time. But we aren't at all surprised by the fact that the son of encouragement wants to pick this one up, who's now ready to go again, and bring him along to do good things, are we? We're not at all surprised that Barnabas would want to build up. We're not at all surprised that Barnabas, the one who, when he saw a window of opportunity, went and found this guy named Saul, because he thought maybe he could be helpful in Antioch, and brought him along, even though he had kind of run away from everything, even though he had kind of left the scene for a while. Barnabas said, no, you know, I think he might be good for something here. Little did Barnabas know what he was starting. Now, the story of John Mark doesn't unfold, as far as we know, into some sort of new Paul that comes about because Barnabas reaches out to him. But we're not at all surprised that Barnabas would do that. But what I want you to particularly notice about this disagreement is the fact that this disagreement and this division over the opinion about John Mark and whether he could go or not does not stop the spread of the gospel. In fact, what happens because Paul and Barnabas split, because they are divided, because they disagree over this idea, guess what happens? The gospel is proclaimed more fully on Cyprus, where Barnabas goes, and we happen to know what happens with Paul and his missionary journey. Disagreements, when used by Satan, bring about the kind of discouragement that stops the mission of God. Disagreements, when we understand that the bigger issue is not our disagreement, but our agreement in Jesus Christ, produces more ministry. Amen. I find it most discouraging when I find Christians disagreeing with each other and the result winds up being that one or both of those two quit. They're not going to do their ministry anymore because we've had a falling out. They're not going to be engaged in a way that they once were because there was a disagreement. In fact, I can't tell you how many times I know the story that there's a disagreement and then there's not just a lack of ministry, but one or both of those people will fall away and decide not to go to church at all. That is Satan's goal in disagreement. God's goal is that we disagree, that we understand that we agree on bigger things than we disagree about, and that God's ministry continues to move forward. Amen. We turn the page to another passage. Chad read this passage. Barnabas goes to Cyprus, and Paul makes a route that we know very little about, through Syria, it's said, which is the area around Antioch. We don't really know very much about what he did there. He then heads to an area called Cilicia, which we're more familiar with because it's headed to where he has been. He and Barnabas were on their previous task, and he winds up in Derbe and Lystra. Now, I don't know about you, but the last time I remember reading about the ministry in Derbe and Lystra, it did not end well. It was a dangerous place for Paul to be, but Paul understood that there was something bigger than danger to self, and it had to do with the survival of those Christians, the encouragement of those people who had dedicated themselves to the proposition that Jesus was the Messiah, he was the Son of God, and he was the answer. They continued to spread the good news of the letter from the church in Jerusalem, that the Gentiles would not be called on to become Jews so that they could follow Christ. Instead, they spread that affirmation by the Jerusalem church that Jesus was enough, and that faith in Jesus was enough, and that the grace of God was what really saved all of us, and that becoming Jewish, practicing circumcision, following the traditions of the law of Moses, those practices were not going to get us any closer to God. They were not the answer for the Jews, and they were not the answer for the Gentiles. Instead, Jesus was enough. They carry that message as they go down the road. And the churches are encouraged by that message. And then we have this interesting little scene where Paul meets a young man named Timothy. We're going to hear more about Timothy if you read the rest of the story. But what Paul does intrigues us because he has Timothy circumcised. And we have to say, what in the world is going on here? Why in the world would we just have a big conference where Paul and Barnabas have to work very hard to establish this concept that Jesus is enough, and now we suddenly want to do that? Well, I think it's a very specific and very powerful way in which Luke indicates the way that Paul, while supporting the concept of Jesus is enough, he also understood the sensibilities of the Jews. And so we are told that Timothy is not just this stray guy off the street, but Timothy is a Jew. His mother was a Jew. And probably because his father, who was a Greek, objected, he was not circumcised. And so Paul says, you need to do what is the tradition of your people, not because it gets you closer to God, but because it will show the Jews who have believed in Jesus that we still respect their idea about what God wants them to do. It's a powerful way in which Paul not only sticks to his convictions, but is sensitive to the people around him. Which, by the way, if you look at all of Paul's ministry, his sensitivity to others is not one of his best traits. But he still does it. As we see this scene, we see Paul following in the instructions of Jesus in a very sort of powerful way. Jesus, when confronted with that idea of, do we pay taxes, understood that there was more at stake there than just the concept that there's more important things than the Roman Empire. He understood that he was at that moment needing to make sure that people understood there's a place and a time for everything. And so he takes the coin and says, look, who's on the coin? Give that part to the Romans. Give your heart, the thing that the image of God is on, to God. He's following the way that Jesus talked about making sure that we stick to our guns about the principles of God, and at the same time don't push people any further away than we have to with the message of God's goodness. It is a ministry of multiplication. I can be all things to all people. It is the ministry of the idea of partnership. We too, although we are so different, can link arms together for higher and greater goals than we thought. There's a particular way in which Paul is following in Jesus' instructions and that I want to also mention in this scene. And that is that as Jesus sent the disciples out, he sent them out two by two. Here Paul had his former partner, Barnabas, and he separated from him. He then pulls Silas along with him, and then he sees a young man who he thinks can be helpful, and he brings him along as well. Are we in the process, as we unfold our Christian walk, to think as strongly about our morality, as strongly about the ideas and the principles of the gospel, as we do about this idea of always having someone that we're bringing along with us? Do you know who you're mentoring, and do you know who you're being mentored by? Are you always aware that I want to bring somebody along with me? Because Jesus thought it was really important to always bring somebody along with him. We need to be that kind of folk. We need to be ready to multiply anywhere we can, and we need to be looking for those partners in the gospel, everywhere we can. And finally, the passage ends with this little travel note. It's not unusual for Luke to put a travel note together. He did it in the gospel. Jesus went from here to there. But this one's written in a very sort of unique way, and it has a great deal to say about what the gospel is doing. Paul and his companions traveled through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word in the province of Asia. When they came to the border of Mysia, they tried to enter Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them to. So they passed by Mysia and they went on down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision of a man from Macedonia standing and begging him, come over to Macedonia and help us. After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. I would truly like to know a few more details about this trip. I would truly like to know what the roadblocks looked like that kept him from going into Asia, which is probably moving back northeast from where his road was taking him, from Lystra and Derbe, and probably on down the road to Pisidian Antioch. I would like to know what the roadblock was as he came to the border of Mysia and wanted to go into Bithynia, all names that mean absolutely nothing to us, and yet the principle is very much there. Probably a turn due north to go there. And yet the Spirit of Jesus stopped him from going there. I want to know what that looks like. I want to see what these doors that are closed really were. We, of course, very quickly associate the Spirit with some sort of mystical event. But I don't think in any way that's what has to have taken place, because the next occurrence where their directions are led by the Spirit is very mystical. A vision of a man from Macedonia calling him to come that direction. And so if it was a vision at all the other stops, why wouldn't Luke have recorded that? We don't know this. This is not a given. But I want to propose to you the idea that it was simply circumstances that did not let them go that direction. Maybe it was somebody was not feeling well and they didn't think that that would be a good direction to go. Maybe it was that literally there was too much traffic on that road to go that way. Maybe it was that the Roman authorities said it's not safe to go that way and wouldn't let them, as Roman citizens, head down that road. We don't know. We are not given those details. But what we are aware of is that it is a different kind of experience than what happened in Troas with a vision. I'm engaged by that. I'm challenged by that. I'm always looking for the Spirit to move in some sort of miraculous hand, a way that's absolutely undeniable. Clearly the Spirit is leading me here. I'm always looking for that vision, that dream that God sends, so that I can really know that the Spirit's at work. I believe, brothers and sisters, that Paul did not need a vision to know that the Spirit was at work in his life. I don't think that Paul had to have a voice or some sort of mystical experience for him to know that the Spirit was guiding his steps and helping him get where he needed to be. That is because he had a different perspective. He had a perspective that said, everywhere I go, the Spirit is leading. Everywhere I can't, I'm going to believe that the Spirit has closed that door and there's something else that I'm supposed to be about. Now, one of the things I want to be sure you understand is that the gospel did go to Asia at some point, and the gospel did go to Bithynia at some point, but it is not where the Spirit wanted Paul to be. We can turn the page and see the power of Paul's ministry around the Aegean Sea: Philippi, Thessalonica, Corinth, Athens, Ephesus. And we can understand maybe that the Spirit was moving him to that effective kind of ministry. It is the place where so much of his writing takes place. It is the people that he invested his life in. It is the place where he brought the gospel into a world that was so much bigger than it had ever been in before. But to accomplish that, the Spirit had to close doors. I want to be a person who has that kind of perspective. I want to be a person who takes the times in life where something says stop, and I want to be able to say that's as much the Spirit moving in my life as when a church invites me to come preach for them, like this church did nearly 6 years ago. I want to see the Spirit of God working in every step of my life. Now, I'm not asking you to become somebody that says every time you turn around, the Spirit did this and the Spirit did that. That can be abusive in certain ways. But what we do need to be is a people that see God's hand at work in our lives. And we're not just talking about that theoretically, but we're looking for it. And we're looking for the way that the Spirit is opening ministry up to us that couldn't have happened if we hadn't have been there. I promised you I would give you a little bit more information. We were all set to take care of a problem. I turned 50 this year, and that requires some medical kind of things. And those medical procedures discovered a mass in my colon. It was tested several different ways, found no cancer whatsoever, and so a very simple procedure was scheduled. And I was so excited about this simple procedure because it was going to solve all my problems. I was not going to have to spend a night in the hospital. It was going to be great. And I could take a little rest, be back with you as soon as possible. And God said no. I can create all kind of excuses for why God said no. None of them hold a bit of water. But he said no to simple things. I believe protecting me from something, but I also believe probably providing some ministry that I'm really not completely aware of yet. If nothing else, when I come to see you in the hospital, I'm going to have spent a few days there myself, and maybe I'll be a little better at that ministry than I was before. But Tuesday we're going to show up, and as opposed to a simple, quick, and go home procedure, it's going to be a more involved procedure, and I'll spend about 2 or 3 days in the hospital. They're going to remove about 6 or 8 inches of my colon and put me back together, and we'll see where it goes from there. It's such a silly way to talk about the power of this passage, isn't it? And yet what I want you to know is, as disappointing as Tuesday was, and as mad as I was when I came out of anesthesia, and they say, well, we didn't do anything. And I said, what? Because you don't just walk in the door for this kind of a thing. I was mad. Mad at a doctor. And then I realized, you know what I'm really mad about? Is I was really hoping that this problem could be solved like that. And it's not going to be. It's going to take a little more effort. And I'm going to have to be still, which I'm not very good at, by the way. And I'm going to have to be somebody that they have to tend to in a hospital room. And I've never looked forward to that. It's never happened to me before. But what I believe is that the Spirit closed a door to bless me, and that the Spirit has opened a door in ways that you can't imagine. That this is happening this quickly is just miraculous. And I believe somewhere in that process, He's going to offer an opportunity to greater ministry in His kingdom. I don't really know where that's going to be. Just as when Paul arrived at Troas, what he had done is simply followed the road where the road led, the main road led to Troas, and here I am. Won't I be surprised if God provides a vision of ministry while I'm in that bed? But He doesn't have to do that for me to know that His Spirit is alive and working in my life. I invite you to become people who are looking for the Spirit, who are yearning for the Spirit, who have a perspective that says, God is working in my life, and His presence, as Scripture reveals, is His Holy Spirit, and He's not just sitting there waiting to assure me that I have eternal life, but He's working to bless me, and here's the big one, He's working to bring ministry through me. And that we want to see every aspect of our life is something that He can use for His ministry. I want to pray. Join me. Father God, I want to thank You for the journey that each and every one of us is on. I want to thank You for the times that You close doors for each of us. And I want to thank You for all the times when You open doors. Father, I want to pray that we would be people who on a regular basis see Your hand involved in our lives. Father, I want to pray that that's not simply about some sort of economic advantage or some getting a parking spot at the Walmart. But instead, Father, we see your hand working in our lives so that we can be witnesses for you, so that we can be about your business of ministry, so that we can be your blessing everywhere we go. May our perspective change to see that. May our hearts be led to be those witnesses. May we follow in the footsteps of Jesus, who was followed by the apostles, and now 2,000 years later, we're invited to walk down the road and to know when you close a door and to say thank you and then to walk through the open ones for your gospel. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, and the whole church said, amen. Thank you for being here today. It is my belief that I won't be back next Sunday. But you know what? If God closes that door, I'll assume that something else good is going to happen. I invite you to come and respond to a God who not only created the earth however many millennia ago, but he sent his son 2,000 years ago to die and to be buried and to raise him up again. But here's the last part of what I want to say. I invite you to come to a God who's alive and well and working today.
Amen.
Won't you come as we stand and sing? We mentioned it earlier, and they've decided to come forward for prayers. We're thankful that they've come. I hope you know George and Amanda Valise, and if you don't, you need to be sure you come down here and meet them before they go. George has asked that we pray for him. We'll be in BASIC for 8.5 weeks at Lackland, and then in June he'll go to tech school in Mississippi to work on his MOS, his chosen field of cyber intelligence. And we would pray that he'll be able to come home from tech school. Everybody ready to get this note? We got a specific prayer request to be present for the birth of our daughter, Melanie. We want that to happen in a big way. And we really want the military to know that he needs to do that. And so we'll pray for them. And I would ask that if you would, as kind of a symbol of your support of this prayer, would you please stand and just kind of maybe even extend your hand this direction. We're going to pray over George and Amanda. Father God, we are thankful for the people that you bring into our lives and for the blessing that they bring to us, and it is our hope that your blessing flows from us into them. We're very thankful for George and Amanda being a part of this congregation, even if it's been for this limited time. We lift George up to you. We are thankful that he has chosen to serve in this way. We would pray that you would bring special blessings on him for that. And we Pray that you would protect him in that decision, and that each step along the way he will feel your hand guiding and leading and helping him. Father, they have asked not only that he be protected and provided for in his endeavors, but that we want to pray that that same protection and provision would come to Amanda as they are separated, as the baby continues to grow, as good things go on in her life. And we're thankful that we, in a very unique way, get to be your hands and feet of ministry to her for at least a little while longer. Father, we pray specifically for the circumstances to come together in a way that George gets to be here for the birth of this child. We see that as very important, and we lift that idea up to you. Beyond that, Father, we want to lift this couple to you. We want to ask that their whole lives will be dedicated to walking and following you, that they will take this new child and point them in your direction as well. We thank you for this opportunity to pray over them. We pray your blessings in their life. And we all pray together. And the whole church said, amen and amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
All of our visitors here, and we have some token of our appreciation we'd like to pass out to you, and it's bread that we'd like to give you to remind you of how much we appreciate you being here. We have a couple of additional announcements. Today is a special day for one person. He turns 18 today. We'd like to say a happy birthday to Jesus and proud of him, and we know that he's going to join the military soon, and so let's have a praise for Jesus' birthday. Thank you. I have a pretty long note here, and I think I'm going to go ahead and read it. I was thinking about cutting it short, but I think it's best if I read it. It's from Jennifer Fugate, and I think most of you know who she is and the trouble she's gone through, but there's opportunities for ministry that we run across, and this is one of them. And it says, "Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I wanted to personally thank you all for everything you've done, for all the food you sent to me and my family, to the wonderful cards and visits, and multiple people at church who either helped us emotionally by just being there or literally physically by helping us clean up more homes, clean up and move homes during our extreme time of need. I just wanted to let you know how much I truly appreciate all that you've done, and that I am now on the long road to recovery, where I have just finished my sixth round of chemo. I am still temporarily here in Houston near the MD Anderson, but should be returning back to Surfside within the month. I will be undergoing a big surgery in the next couple of rounds that includes removing the remainder of the tumor as well as the cyst in my ovary and performing a full titanium hip replacement. This will unfortunately be an extremely long recovery process where I'll spend 4 weeks in the hospital allowing my bones to merge with a new hip, 6 months outside of the hospital on crutches, and then a full year of physical therapy as well as maintenance chemo in order to make sure that the cancer is completely gone. I still have a ways to go, but my faith has kept me strong. I hope all is well back in Lake Jackson and to see you all soon. Take care and God bless. Sincerely, Jennifer Fugate." For a 21 somewhat your woman, this is amazing, and we really want to we're glad we've done what we've done, and we want to reach out to her as this, you know, a year's worth of recovery is still in front of her. And so we want to remember her in her prayers and in our prayers, and try to bless her and her family every way we can. We'd also like to say a special prayer for Allen today, and we're going to invite any and all of y'all to come forward and to gather around him and pray for him. And the rest of our announcements are on the caring and sharing, and if there's any questions about any of that, ask any of us and we'll be glad to help you. So if you could come forward, if you feel like it, coming forward to gather around Allen, we'd appreciate it. You know, I thought of a funny 100 funny things to say about Allen and his surgery, and I'm just gonna let them all go. And so, Lord, as we close our service here today, we want to thank you for the blessings that we've had of being here. We thank you for the George and Amanda that's come forward and for the prayers that they've asked, and we pray for great things for them, as Alan so already worded. Lord, we pray for our congregation that we can continue to grow and that we can reach out and touch people in our daily lives, and we'll pray for that we can have opportunities like Jennifer Fugate, that we can help them and show your love to them and show your compassion for them and be your arms and feet and hands right here in Lake Jackson. Lord, we pray for Alan and the surgery that he's going to have this week. We pray for Sharon as she attends to him and the doctors that are performing that surgery. We pray that it goes well and that it goes just exactly as they planned and that things work out perfectly and that he returns back to us in his good health in a matter of just a few days. We're thankful for the opportunity that we live of living in a country and a place that has such good hospitals and good medicine. And we pray that we know that's a blessing from you, and it's not just all man-made things, that so many things are your intervening and helping those that are sick. Lord, we ask you to pray for, be with all of those that are on our prayer list as we pray for them in our daily prayers, as we reach out to touch them, as we let them know we love them and we care for them. And we thank you for being united together here today, united as a family of Christians, united as being part of your body that's left here on this earth to serve our fellow man and each other in these times of need. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the sacrifice that was made for our sins by him so that we could be forgiven and that we could be blameless. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Hey!